Gospel from 1 to 11. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 4, 1 to 11. I'm not going to read as I preach, I can read because of time constraints. So let us pray. Our loving God, we thank you for this day, O Master, Lord, as we expound your word, O Lord. Lord, as we receive this word, let us bring forth, let your word bring forth fruit in our lives, O Master.
Amen.
And let your name be glorified
Amen.
In ourselves, O Master. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray.
Amen. Amen.
As you know, the title of the message is there in your Bible itself. I'm not going to change. It's there. It's the temptation of Christ. Okay? It's very simple.
Yes.
Temptation. We are in a Lenten period, am I right? We are in a holy month. And so we have to speak something relevant to the cross.
Right?
Yeah. I'm not going to speak about the blood, okay? But something is relevant with our day-to-day life, the temptations of Christ. We live in a world of terrorism.
Yes.
You understand? So people say, let us fight terrorism. So, some people say, let's fight terrorism with terrorism. But when you fight terrorism with terrorism, more terrorism comes.
Yes.
And some people say, okay, let us invite the terrorists. Let us sit and talk with them and see what their demands are and accede to their demands. But what is happening in the secular world is also happening in the Christendom also. There are many believers who are either forgotten or refuse to acknowledge that we are in a spiritual warfare. Many Christians have already raised the white flag to the devil, the number one enemy. And they have signed a peace treaty with the enemy of God. In spiritual arena, there are two types of people. Either you are the victor are the victims. Either you are victorious or defeated. There is no neutral ground. If you pretend there is no Satan, and Satan is not after you, your family, your children, your business, your life, and if the devil is succeeded till today, then God's people have already wave the white flag to the enemies.
Yes.
But looking to all these situations, what can we study from the temptation of Jesus? It reminds us that Jesus can understand our temptations. It reveals how can we ourselves be successful in overcoming temptation. Because Christ is our pattern. That is why we read in Matthew chapter 4, verse 1 to 11. It says, let me read it for you. First three verses. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the desert to be tempted by the devil. After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. The tempter came to him and said, if you are the Son of God, tell the stones to become bread. See, if you read in Mark chapter 1, it is very stronger. That means, immediately the Spirit drove him into the wilderness.
Mm.
He has fasted, and immediately, sometimes the temptation will be like that. It will drive him so fast.
Mm.
But here the unique aspect is, the Holy Spirit led him into the wilderness.
Right.
To be tempted by the devil. That's an interesting thing. You understand? If the Holy Spirit led him to the devil to be tempted. But here we see some practical application from the text. Jesus exposed Satan and his tactics, and he defeated Satan. Because he has victory, because of his victory, we can also be victorious over the tempter.
Amen.
But the question is, it's very simple to say, then done. But the question is, the devil gets victory over our lives most of the time. The question is, when did you last yield to the temptation? This morning? Yesterday night?
Huh? So true.
But when God wants you to be able to share in the victory of Christ, God wants you to share in the victory of Christ over temptations. So we can be sure this morning that if Christ can be victorious, you can also be victorious through Christ.
Amen.
Amen.
That is very important, not on ourselves.
Amen.
Through Christ we can be victorious.
Amen.
You understand?
Yes.
The first thing, Christ was victorious over the temptations of passionate desire. Number one. The point here is, Jesus has fasted for 40 days and 40 nights. He was preparing himself for the ministry. And suddenly the devil comes and he puts a question here. Now there is a dilemma in Jesus' mind. Should I obey my father's or should I fulfill my desire?
Mm-hmm.
Should I wait for my father's timing or should I take things on my own hand? Should I continue to play my father's business above my business? Should I be the servant of my father's business in my life, or should I try to get the father's serve my purpose in life? So this was the question when the devil posted the question to Jesus. Jesus was thinking about these things. Many people today do not believe that there is a devil. Am I right?
Yes. Yes.
But the Bible says, the word, the tempter, in 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, it says, here the devil is called the tempter.
Mm-hmm.
If I'm right, it's called 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 5. The tempter. That is one of the names of the devil. You understand? And the Bible teaches, he's a real person, by the way. He's not, see, some commentators argue, what Christ was experiencing was a mind battle.
Mm-hmm.
It was not a real devil.
Mm-hmm.
Something which was happening in his mind.
Yeah.
You understand?
Yeah.
But this is not a mind battle. It was the devil.
Real.
We do not know in what form.
Yes.
Whenever we assume devil, it's not a devil in the form of a skull with a fork knife or a red monster. The devil can come in any form.
Amen.
Because he's an angel of light.
That's right.
The devil can come in a very beautiful form.
Yes.
You understand? So
yes.
Don't always think the devil will look very bad. Ugly. No. It can take a deceptive form. So you have to be very careful. So temptation comes for different people in different ways.
Yes.
In Jesus, see, when Jesus went through this temptation, he was not sitting in a cool room. He was in the desert.
Mm-hmm.
And the desert was hot.
Yes.
The desert was very vast desert. It started from between Jerusalem and to the Dead Sea. And it was like sitting on a furnace. Hot furnace.
Mm.
You know, go and sit on the furnace and see what happens. Such a, you know. So that was the time. So that was the time the temptation came, or the devil tempted Jesus. And Jesus not only hungered, if you fast for 40 days, 40 nights, in such a horrible condition, deplorable situations, Jesus not only hungered, he was undergoing a kind of famine, not only hunger, it was famine. You understand? He was thirsty. And devil knew. The devil did not come on the first day. He came on the 40th, on the 40th day.
Yes.
So that was the onslaught of recurring when your hunger is increasing. That was the opportunity for the devil to tempt you.
Yes.
When you are in the peak of your thirst for anything,
that's right.
The devil will strike you easily. So be careful at that time.
Yes.
That is the opportunity for the devil to present itself to strike you.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes many of we fall flat to those temptations.
Mm-hmm.
Because we are unexpected to those situations.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes Satan may tempt us of our bodily weakness.
Mm-hmm.
He may tempt you in spiritual weakness.
That's right.
In times of his, many times we are all Bible college students, but that's a different story. But then, if you have missed several weeks of church, that is the time. time devil will trap you down.
That's right.
Or that is the time you're vulnerable for the temptations of the Satan. Sometimes you may be strong and self-confident. You understand, oh, I am praying 24/7. I am speaking in tongues 365 days and this is G6 and Nymphios. But anyway, you might be thinking you're strong and self-confident. But that is the time. Because you're overconfident.
Yes.
You know, many preachers, great preachers, were in the presence of the Lord. You know, they were 24/7 in the presence of God and they fall flat. Mm-hmm. Because he knows, because of the self-confidence.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to be very careful. Temptation is tailor-made. It can come in different form for you. It can come for different form. It's a package.
Mm-hmm.
Do not expect temptation the same way tempted your friend. Yes. It can come in different ways.
That's right.
It's a tailor-made package. You understand?
Yes.
So here in this case, the Satan tempted differently.
Yes.
Because Satan, Jesus was the Son of God.
Yes.
And Satan is going before Jesus and asking, oh, since you are God's Son, you have to make use of your power, majestic power.
Yes.
How can you be a Son of God and you are hungry? It's ridiculous. You call yourself Son of God and you are hungry. And your Father is supposed to be God, the Father is your Father.
Yes.
If God is your Father, how can you be hungry?
Yeah.
Many times, you know, you have experienced this.
Mm-hmm.
God is your Father. Huh?
Yes.
So Satan tempted to produce power instantly to make food for Jesus. We live in a microwave society.
Mm-hmm.
Instant food, you know. Everything is instant.
Yes.
You want fast food, you can't wait. We can't wait. Everything we need instant food.
Mm-hmm.
But only with this you can't get instant babies. Listen to me carefully.
Yes.
Jesus could turn desert stones into bread. It's very easy for him to do that.
Yes.
But he chose not to do.
Yes.
You understand? Satan is a very crafty guy.
Mm-hmm.
He's trying to, Satan was tempting Christ to act independently of the Holy Spirit. Because who led him to the wilderness?
The Holy Spirit.
So he's trying to tempt Jesus to go independently.
Mm.
He was seeking to destroy the Son's confidence in the Father's will. Who sent him? Father sent him. Now he's trying to bring a distrust.
Yes.
And the confidence, he was trying to break that. He was trying to put a wedge between the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
You understand? And he was trying to elevate physical over the natural. He was saying, oh, you're hungry, Jesus. Do not forget about the spiritual aspect. First, you need food.
Mm-hmm.
Take care of that.
Yes.
He was tempting Jesus in all these three aspects.
Mm-hmm.
You have to be very careful. Whenever there is, the enemy will always try to put dissension, discord, strife, enmity, jealousy, pride, all these. Whenever there is a dissension, whenever there is a disenharmonment, or whenever there is a strife, you can understand you have already allowed the enemy into the circumstances.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes.
But one thing, all the three temptations, Jesus resisted by the scripture.
Mm-hmm.
Here we see, Jesus quotes from Deuteronomy chapter 8 verse 3. It says, how did Jesus, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. The key word is alone. Your life is not sustained by bread. You understand?
That's right.
Your life is not sustained by bread, but by his word. That is why in John chapter 4, he says, my food is to do the will of God. Your food is to do the will of God.
Yes.
Are you able to do it without eating food?
Huh?
But Jesus said, my food is to do the will of the Father. So
yes,
his main concern was not the physical aspect of food.
Amen.
He was thinking of the spiritual aspect of the food. You understand? To do the will of the Father. If you see that the people of Israelites were led, were in the wilderness, and they were asking for manna. You understand? And that is why, and they said that, that is why Jesus was telling that, and how, and in that episode, God brought bread for them. And how did God brought that bread? By His word. By His word, He brought forth manna from heaven. God brought for His people. So Jesus says, the word here refers the word of His power. You understand? That is why it is His word of effective command. In Genesis 1:3, God created everything by His word. So God provided by speaking into existence.
Yes.
Where there's nothing. He just spoke the word.
Yes.
So Jesus is giving a childlike confidence in the Father's care. He is certainly the one who, when there was no bread, has provided manna, would not fail His beloved Son in this hour of trial. As the Son, Jesus was obeying the Father by being in the wilderness, that God the Father will provide His Son. So Jesus did not worry. So there we see that Jesus was victorious over the temptations of the passionate desire. Whereas the passion means you need not think in a sexual context. It's everything, passion for many things. But Jesus was able to be victorious in the first round of the battle. The second round of the battle was Christ was victorious over the temptations of presumption. Let me read verse 5. Then the devil took him to the holy city and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. If you are the Son of God, he said, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and they will lift you up in their hands, so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. Jesus answered him, it is also written, do not put the Lord your God to test. That is the second temptation here. So Jesus took him to, Satan took Jesus to a temple complex. It was not over the temple. According to archaeologists, they say that Jesus was standing over the edge of the wall. From that wall, there is several feet down, you can see the Kidron Valley. So the moment you go and stand near the edge of the wall, the retaining wall, and if you sit down, immediately you will have a psychological experience of falling down. You'll soon. The mere look of it. I've been to Niagara once. And the moment you go up and see on the edge of it, you feel that you're falling down. So there's no need for somebody to push you down. The moment you see, you fall down. See, here we see Satan was a very clever guy. He was trying to tempt psychologically, physically, making him to stand at the edge of the retaining wall. The moment you see, you're about to fall. But here we see, so that was the temptation there, you understand? It was psychological warfare going on between Satan and Christ. The essence of the temptation, that is why he says in verse 6, follow me, if you are the Son of God. So you are the Son of God. So Jesus, the Satan is asking, so you are the Son of God. So trust your Father. You can't do anything. You are not doing anything. No. In this temptation, he's asking, let your Father do something for you. You got it?
Yes.
Let your Father, so you trust your Father, let your Father work out something for you. If you will not work out a miracle for yourself, then let God the Father work out a miracle for you. See, sometimes, listen to me carefully, if the devil can't fight you, I told this in the class, it's always good to have the devil in front of you. Because you can punch it. You understand? Don't go and punch it. But sometimes, listen to me, it's always good to have the devil in front, but sometimes you can't fight. The devil will come along with you. That is the dangerous moment. Because you do not know who is along with you. He will easily pull you down,
yes,
or push
yes.
you down. So it's better to have in front And he's quoting from Psalm 91 verse 12. If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down. For it is written, who is quoting? It's not Jesus quoting, by the way, it's devil quoting. Understand? Devil has two scriptures. He will command his angels concerning you, and they will put, and they will lift up in their hands. So you will not strike your foot. But it's very cunning. Devil did not give the full verse there. He says,
yes.
If you read chapter 91, verse 11, 12, it says, he will command his angels concerning, and they will lift you up in their hands in all your ways. That means, it's not a promise. Whatever you do, God is going to protect your foot. Devil is trying to eliminate the two words and says, Jesus, you do whatever you want, God is there to protect you. No, no. If you read Psalms 91, verse 11, 12, in all your ways, in God's ways, if you do, God will protect.
Right.
Not on your own ways. You understand?
That's right.
Sometimes we try to do some foolish thing and expect God to say, yes. You understand? God did not command Jesus to fall down. Fall from the temple. If Jesus would have commanded, Jesus easily would have fallen down and God would have protected. God did not command Jesus to do that. It was devil's idea. Many times we always operate on our self-will.
Yes.
And we expect God's approval to bless it as is God's will. Do not do foolish things and demand God to deliver you from the result of foolish actions.
Yes.
Sometimes in His mercy and His grace, He will do it.
Yes.
But you cannot expect it all the times.
That's right.
My dear brothers in Christ, sometimes we try to test God, or tempt God. I'm having this sickness, God. I'm having this financial problem. God, if you're really God, solve my problem. Otherwise, you're not God. You are dead. You are tempting God.
Of course.
Yes.
Of course.
Many times you do this for me. I will serve you.
Yes.
You understand? Many a times we try to tempt God by the situation. But God's rescuing power is not to be something to be experimented. It is something to be trusted in everyday life.
Amen.
Right.
It's perfect submission to God's will.
Yes.
And if you are in the center of God's will, God will do perfectly for you. So we see that Jesus was able to be victorious over the temptations. The second temptation. The third one is, Christ was victorious over the temptation of the power. Very interesting. Everybody wants power. Am I right?
Yes.
Or we want to surround ourselves with power. Or we want to stick with someone who has power.
Right.
You understand?
Yes.
You can say, I know the Prime Minister. You understand? Why? Because he has power. You do not want to say, I know the guy who works in there is a helper in the Prime Minister's office. You do not want to say that. She might be an aunt or uncle. But you say, I know the Prime Minister, but you do not want to identify the person who works in the Prime Minister's office. Maybe if she's a secretary, you say, you understand? But you always want to be identified with somebody. With power. The first temptation, listen to me. He was trying Jesus to do something. In the second temptation, he's asking God the Father to do something for Jesus. In the third and the final temptation, he offered himself to Jesus in exchange for Jesus to bow down. You understand? The essence of temptation in verse 8, let me read it for you. Again the devil took him into a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and the splendor, and all this I will give you, he said, if you will bow down and worship me. Satan said to him, away from me, Satan, for it is written.
Jesus.
Yes.
Jesus said.
For it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only, then the devil left him. Here the word, the Greek word showeth. The devil showeth Jesus. It's a beautiful word. That means the devil is trying to convince Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
The word show is not an ordinary show. It's not a fashion show.
Mm-hmm.
The devil, when the devil comes and tempts you, he will give convincing evidences.
Yes.
That is the word show.
That's right.
You understand? Sometimes you have to be very careful because it will be highly convincing for you to fall down. Mm-hmm. So you should know which is the original one. But the question is, see, the interesting thing is, Satan showed the whole world. How can that is a miracle? He took him to a highest pinnacle, and Satan showed the whole world. How can one person show the whole world at one point of time? You all of you understood?
That's right.
You go stand up the hill. We are on the hill. Can you see whole of Kingston from here?
Mm-hmm.
Can't see that. So how can Satan show Jesus the whole of the Jerusalem? It says Euphrates, Egypt. It is a miracle by itself, but it is a poetic way of saying. It's not that Jesus literally saw the whole world. Nobody can see from the one point of time to see the whole world. You got it?
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, that's a different aspect. So he showed the whole expanse of the earth, the power, the glory of the Greek culture, the Roman power, everything. Jesus, I show you everything. You can take it all this you want. See, but you have to understand very carefully. There is an indication. But then you can ask, how can Satan make a promise like that? Listen to me. How can Satan make a promise of giving everything? So how did the earth go into Satan's hand? The moment Adam and Eve sinned against God, Adam and Eve gave the keys of the earth into the hands of Satan. You understand? So that is how Satan has temporary control over you. He has temporary control and he does not have a permanent control, my dear brothers. Now let us see how Jesus was tempted. He was tempted in two aspects. Personal ambition. You can become the king of the world. The next, see anybody if you want, that is an interesting temptation. When this incident happened, millions of people have come to Jerusalem. And Satan was telling, if you jump from this top, and if you fall down, and people will see you, and if nothing happens to you, they will make you a king. You do not want that thing to happen. So here we see that he was appealing to the personal ambitions. You want to become a king, man? Just bow down before me. Very simple. No. Instant gratification. You understand? Immediately.
Yes.
But considering the fact that Jesus is the Messiah, and in one day he's going to set up a kingdom on the earth. That's the promise from his Father.
Mm-hmm.
But when? It is after 3.5 years of ministry and going through Gethsemane and through cross. So the Satan is telling, you are a fool, man.
Mm.
Why do you have to go through this cross? Why do you have to go through Gethsemane when you can have the whole kingdom now?
Right now. Yes.
So Satan was trying to circumvent, short circuit, or a shortcut the plan of God.
Yes.
He was telling, you are the son of a carpenter. You throughout your life you are struggling. Why can't you become the king now?
Right.
Sometimes Satan will tempt us to have it right now.
Yes.
You have to be very careful.
Yes.
That is the temptations. You understand? So he was trying to Satan knew if Jesus go to the cross, very interesting, it's all over for him.
Yeah.
If I can corrupt, not me, Satan. If Satan can corrupt him now and make him fall, he can have controlled by heaven.
Yes.
All of you got it?
Yes.
He was trying to scatter the plan of God.
Yes.
If Jesus can fall, and he can be the king forever. And Jesus' response was very interesting. Away with you, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, him only. And Jesus simply said, Jesus' reply was simply, God forbids it. And he quoted from Exodus chapter 20, verse 3. You shall have no other God. That is what Jesus is indirectly telling. You understand? The goal of Satan's temptation was that Christ would leave and God would not honor Jesus and would not honor Jesus' distrust, and Messiah would fall upon the rocks, and that would be the end of the plan of salvation. My dear brothers in Christ, Satan was trying to exchange the approval of the Father for the approval of the world. Devil is trying to exchange the applause of the man for the applause of the heaven.
Yes.
Satan is trying to exchange the supernatural for the natural. Many times we do things because we want to get the applause of the man. Jesus was tempted whether to get the... See, if he would have fallen down and if he would have been alive, he would have got the applause of the world and he would have been made the king. Instantaneously, without going through the 3.5 years of gruesome pain and agony, the cross. If Jesus would have jumped, he would have become popular. But how long the popularity would have lasted? The popularity couldn't have redeemed humanity. Popularity would have brought temporary sensation. But sensation is short-lived.
That's right.
Sensation never saves any people. It can create excitement,
yes,
but it cannot bring eternal life.
Amen.
That is why I am telling you time and again, whenever you speak, speak the word of God.
That's right.
Your message need not be sensational.
That's right.
It can create emotionalism. Yes. I can take the mic and go here and that, jump up and down. But that is not going to bring any radical change in your life.
Right. That's right.
Your message should have standard word in that. There should be some quality for the devil to run away from. Jesus did not take a mic and he was not playing some excitement there. He spoke the literal word of God. You as young preachers, you are trying to replicate. You understand? To be, if I speak very high, if I take my mic and jump, oh, people will appreciate me. Do not be carried away with sensationalism.
Amen.
There is no place for sensation.
That's right.
If you have seen me preaching or another place preaching, we are sticking to the place where we are. It's good to preach sensationalism. But watch out for these people who are speaking sensationalism. There is no word. It can bring excitement, but there's no power in it.
Yes.
The devil cannot run away from your message. If there is no power, it can create excitement.
Amen.
Oh,
amen.
What a wonderful message we have.
Amen.
How did he speak? Nothing.
Amen.
Seriously.
So here we have to be very careful. Whether we are Jesus, see, popularity couldn't have saved us. Redeemed us. That is why it is said again, it is written again, you shall not tempt the Lord.
Yes.
Finally. See, when the people were in the wilderness, they were asking, Lord, if you are really God, give us water. We are suffering from thirst and hunger. Give me water now. Sometimes instead of waiting on God's provision, we are putting God to test. I already told
you.
Yes. Do not put God to test. True faith does not demand signs, my dear brother in Christ. True faith does not demand signs or miracles.
Amen.
But simply believe the word of God. It's very easy to say. Simply, brother, do not expect miracles or signs to believe God. Whether miracles or signs happen or happen, was able to overcome all the three temptations through the word.
Yes.
You and I go through the temptations every day.
Hmm.
Nobody can say, I am insulated or isolated from a temptation. Everybody go through temptation. Sometimes you fall.
That's right. Yes. Yes.
But
yes,
we rise up again and we still we are victorious.
Amen.
That is why we have to be very careful when people fall down. Do not condemn them. Because there are times you will fall. The same people who condemn you, him or you or her, the first person to throw the stone. But we are still victorious because Christ is our victor.
Amen.
You will be falling here and there in ministry, but Christ as an example for us.
Amen.
The last but not the least another story goes like this. When the hawk is attacked by the crows, the hawk, it's a kind of bird, attacked by the crows or kingbirds, he does not counterattack. When the hawk is a bird, when it is attacked by a crow or a kingbird, big birds, what does the hawk does? It soars higher and higher in winding circle until the tormentor leaves. It does not counterattack. Every time the crows or the kingbird try to attack, it goes higher and higher until the tormentor leaves.
Hmm.
You understand? How can you go higher and higher through the word?
Amen.
Every time the devil tempts you or tests you, you just fly higher and higher until the tormentor leaves you.
Amen.
It might be any situation that you are going through. You might understand. You may feel that a pain of rejection or injustice, unfairness, false accusation you have experienced in your life. My dear brothers in Christ, Jesus has gone beyond to what you have experienced.
Amen.
And still, he was victorious.
Amen.
So you can also be victorious in all your circumstances. In all your situations, you can be victorious. Because Christ is our pattern.
Amen.
Let's close our eyes and pray.